Well, again, good morning, everyone. And it's great to see an excellent turnout. We've got a full room. We've got a great agenda. And so, first of all, I'd like to call the 126th meeting. Someone out there is keeping close count, but the 126th meeting of the National Petroleum Council will now come to order. I want to welcome all of you, members of the council, as well as honored guests, members of the press, and the public as well. I think we have an excellent agenda today, and it should be a productive meeting. As we always do, before we get started, just a safety announcement. We're not anticipating any fire alarms today, but in case there should be an alarm sound, we'll want to evacuate this room. We're on the ground floor, of course, and our exits will be right back through the back of the room. And you can go two ways. Once you go there, you can go out into the courtyard or through the lobby and out the front. But we will want to evacuate the building, go across the street. Muster point will be at the Capitol Hilton Hotel across K Street. Now, hopefully, we won't have to worry about that, but I just want to make sure everybody is prepared in case there's any event. If there's no objection, I will dispense with calling the roll. For members of the council, the sign-in, check-in there in the chandelier room will serve as our official attendance record. If you haven't signed in as you're coming in, please do when you leave so that we'll have a record of your attendance. We also want to just remind everyone that as become a custom, we have an internet off audience that will be able to listen to streaming audio of our proceedings as well as download any presentations. So as we get started, I want to introduce the head table. Shortly, joining us a little bit further into the agenda will, of course, be the Honorable Ernest Moniz, Secretary of Energy. Next is Rex Tillerson, who serves as the Vice Chair of the Council. And next to Rex is Deputy Secretary Elizabeth Sherwood Randall. Liz, we're pleased that you've joined us today and look forward to your comments later in the agenda as well. Next to Liz is Chris Smith. Welcome, Chris. Chris is Assistant Secretary for Fossil Energy. And then next to Chris is Marshall Nichols, our Executive Director of the Council. So as we get started, the first item of business is to receive an update on the NPC's report, Enhancing Emergency Preparedness for Natural Disasters. As many of you recall, this was a report that was prepared at the Secretary's request and was approved back in December of 2014. It provided findings on our nation's emergency plans and recommendations for industry and government to improve preparedness, response, and recovery. It was an excellent report, and it was covering an issue that was vitally important, and that is the security of our systems and infrastructure during any kind of emergency events. And the members, in approving that report, made a commitment to follow through with the Department of Energy. We recognized when that report was being made that the easiest part, and I wouldn't say it was easy, I know that Marvin Odom is here and led that effort. It took a lot of work, but we also realized that that was only a part of the effort that needs to be done, and that is preparing the report and recommendations is one thing, but as all of us know as operating companies, it's being able to execute plans in the event of emergency is critical. And so we realized that implementing the plan will be just as difficult as it was in preparing the plan. So in the Secretary's letter in May 23, 2015, it expressed appreciation to the Council for the report, and he noted there were several areas of implementation that were underway. And in that, he also reiterated the Department's interest in working with industry partners to enhance the energy system's resilience. The department's 2016 annual emergency preparedness exercise provided an opportunity for the industry and government to continue to work and collaborate together as part of emergency preparations, consistent with the commitment that was made in approving the report. The NPC and industry participants assisted the DOE with an exercise called Clear Path 4, and that took place this past April. This exercise provided an opportunity to observe and document progress towards the implementation of the NPC recommendations. And as we all know, as we go through and we exercise emergency plans, we learn a lot, things that needed to be addressed or that could be enhanced. So it was all about building on the recommendations and build on previous work by the Department of Energy and Industry in advancing our preparation. Key participants from the 2014 study, along with several additional members, were convened as a work group to assist and document the follow-on activities, and the results of these are contained in a summary presentation and a working paper which was sent to the members of the NPC Emergency Preparedness Committee about 2 weeks ago for review. We have with us today Phil Smith from Shell, who led the study addendum work group, and he is going to present an overview of their observations this morning. A copy of Phil's presentation it should be in your meeting folders, as well as those who are participating over the internet that should be downloadable also from the NPC website. Also in your folders is a draft letter formally transmitting this material to Secretary Monique. To take us through this study addendum, I'd like to invite Phil Smith to come up and go over that with us, and we'll have an opportunity to ask questions at the conclusion of that. Phil?
Thank you, Chuck. Appreciate that good lead-in, and good morning to all, and thank you for the opportunity to come and report out on the body of work that was done following on this good report. I am Phil Smith. I'm the emergency manager for Shell in North and South America. I was not involved in the original report directly. I certainly was following it, and appreciate all the tremendous work and efforts that went into that report. And also glad to be here as a representative of NPC and industry, who's been working closely with DOE over the past year or so to continue these preparedness efforts. So today, I will kind of bring you up to speed on kind of how we got here, what we've kind of gone through, our approach. I'll give you a summary, a high summary of our findings, and then provide a bit of detail around the recommendations to be implemented from this report. So as Chuck stated, this report was approved back in December of 2014. It did include seven key recommendations that were the focus of the implementation. And it included a commitment, and that commitment was from not only DOE, but NPC and industry towards working towards completing those recommendations and fulfilling those requirements. It involved participation of federal and state governments and industry, and that is what led to this addendum report that I will be reporting out to you on today. So the addendum materials is just this slide deck, as well as a working paper that provides much more detail, and both of these are available on the NPC website. These slides, there's a lot of detail here, so I apologize for that, and a lot of words. I'll run through it relatively quickly, though, and I know you've got copies in front of you. But this does serve as documentation for all the good work that was done following the report, and future for future use and reference. Also, there's a lot of acronyms in here. I apologize in advance for that. But I guess the main takeaway is not to focus on those, but understand that all these groups and acronyms that are represented are all working together towards a common goal. And those are also defined in the working paper. First, just a quick run-through of the high-level findings from the original report. Certainly, understanding the oil and gas supply chains and all their intricacies is critical. Improving our situational awareness, really understand what's going on in the field, is absolutely essential to response, including having effective communications, being able to communicate during the chaos. Maintenance of response organizations we see is absolutely key. And that leads to having an organization in place, making sure it's sustainable with the skills and competencies needed to carry forward a response through time. And then certainly leadership and commitment also for funding and continuous improvement absolutely required. So these findings are what served as the basis of the recommendations of the study. I'll quickly remind you, there were 7 recommendations as stated. The first 4 we kind of organized around what we call operational framework. This is kind of how we set ourselves up, the structure, getting the people in place, getting them trained and competent with established procedures to support the effective response. So you can see here, there's a recommendation around harmonizing DOE's response team structure around the NIMS ICS. ICS being the standard protocol and process that we use for managing incidents and other agencies use as well across the United States. Also leveraging the EIA, Energy Information Administration, as subject matter experts. We saw them as a very key organization in working with DOE, particularly around improving the supply chain situational awareness. Establishing company liaisons, obviously critical, being able to contact the companies involved in the event, and then streamlining and enhancing the processes for obtaining regulatory waivers that are often needed in times of significant disruption. The final 3 are categorized around sustaining the process. This is really how we get to maintaining the system, the care and feeding, if you will, of the program. It's the plans and people necessary to maintain the institutional knowledge. There's a recommendation here around the states and their responsibility to increase engagement with the oil and natural gas industry around energy assurance plans. And industry certainly should assist in that endeavor. Both DOE and states should establish routine education and training programs. That's key going forward. The ICS is a program that requires training, education, and of course exercises. So the 7th and final recommendation is around improving comprehensive drills and exercise programs and making them meaningful and collaborative with agencies and industry involved. So what have we done and what's occurred since the report came out? There's been quite a bit of work done. I've highlighted a few of them here. Certainly DOE has begun implementing elements of NIMS ICS, which is very good to see. We've also created a company contact liaison list. The NPC and the Oil and Natural Gas Sector Coordinating Council has established that list. And DOE has begun participating in industry exercises and increased their engagement in those, which is very good to see. And of course, the big event and the majority of the work went into the Department of Energy's Clear Path 4 exercise, which occurred back in April. This was a significant undertaking, involved a scenario involving a earthquake in the Pacific Northwest and a subsequent tsunami. Quite a scary scenario, if you will, but it provided a great opportunity. Great opportunity for observation, learning, and that served as the primary vehicle for us to establish how are we getting along with these recommendations, and how are we working together to complete them and continue our improvement on preparedness and response. So they were able to identify enhancements to the response plans in this exercise as well, and they tested the effectiveness of the implementation of these study recommendations through a functional exercise. So what specifically did NPC and industry do? I want to frame that up for you. Certainly, Clear Path Forward was a great opportunity for us to collaborate with DOE, but it also served as a great opportunity to observe the progress on the report recommendations. Of course, the exercise was a two-day event. Day one was a tabletop exercise and involved sector-specific workshops around oil and gas and electric sectors. Day two was a functional exercise conducted in DOE's headquarters in Washington and supported by the Portland Forward Command. We were organized as follows and as shown here on this chart, really in three work groups. Work group one identified and recruited oil and natural gas companies from the Pacific Northwest region to come together and participate in the exercise, and also facilitated a fuels workshop in the afternoon of day one there in Portland. Work group two was focused on providing input to DOE for the exercise planning process, actually helping with the planning a bit on the process, and also developed an evaluation guide for the exercise and created injects, which added realism to the Clear Path 4 exercise as well. And then work group three finally was the group that observed the actual functional exercise at DOE headquarters, was able to give us a lot of insights on progress on the recommendations. They not only were involved in the exercise and observing, but also interviewed folks after the interview, reviewed plans and processes, and were able to come up with a very good understanding of our progress in that regard. So you can see the participants from industry listed there, a very good mix of oil and gas companies as well as trade organizations. And again, a tremendous opportunity to review progress through this exercise. And it was a large undertaking and very well done. So what did we see? What did we observe in the way of progress? Certainly, this exercise in itself was a significant step. It was a huge undertaking and showed a commitment on the DOE, and we applaud them very much for that. And it also provided a good avenue for training as well, which all exercises do. DOE's leadership commitment to advancing the preparedness and response program is evident through here, and we encourage them to continue to market that, and it's critical that they are developing and sustaining a preparedness and response program under their emergency support function 12. The EIA participated with ERO as well, the Emergency Response Organization and DOE, and that was a very good progress in our view. We see again as them as a key group and liaison to DOE, particularly for situational awareness where they have tremendous expertise. And then finally, the fuels workshop in the afternoon, I think, was an important area of progress with getting the states of Washington and Oregon together, understanding their fuels plans, which they have in place, and really progressing those and understanding the interdependencies that are involved. So quite a bit of good progress there observed. With all exercises, we like to see progress, but we mainly focus on areas that we can improve, and that's why we do them. It's actually the best way you can actually prepare, other than a real incident, of course. So we really take this to heart, and we look for areas that we can really improve our response capabilities overall. So I've summarized some of the opportunities here for you, starting with some key actions that can be focused towards DOE. Certainly, I mentioned the ICS is critical, and we see that as a continuing effort on DOE's part to fully embed the ICS structure, not only in the roles, but the responsibilities and some of the processes and things that are included with the ICS process. We also see a very critical area to continue to work on around what we call continuity and management of change. And this is really around establishing those positions that are going to know how to work within the ICS program and maintaining those through time. We understand there's a high level of turnover in government, particularly with administrative changes and senior level officials particularly. And so that necessitates a disciplined program where you embed these roles and responsibilities, these positions, and keep them alive through training and a succession plan. This is hard for industry as well. We have high turnover as well, and so it's something we really have to work on. And then finally, you know, embed in a process owner to really own that over time and sustain that into the future. We also see some areas for improvement around engaging some experts, some practitioners. This ICS way of working and responding to incidents has been around since the early 70s, and there's some real experts out there to use as coaches. We in industry use them as well. And then finally, expanding the training and exercises. The functional exercise up in the Pacific Northwest was fantastic in our view. It's a good start. These are the kind of things that help you develop and continue to grow and keep a good response program for the agency. So very good good things to think about there. We also have some things identified for industry to work on. We do have a company contact system, but we've got to keep it alive now. We've got to come up with a process to sustain that, to test that, and keep that evergreen. We also need to formalize a process to share our exercise schedules. I think, and I believe we've almost finished that process through the oil and natural gas coordinating subcommittee. And I think it's really just a posting of all the exercises that industry is undertaking throughout the nation. I think you can almost picture it as a menu, perhaps, of exercises in certain scenarios and certain roles that you may want to plug into to help develop some skills and competencies. So I think that's something that's going to be very helpful going forward. And then also for states, really focused around their energy assurance plans, which is critical, of course, when we have a disruptive event from a natural disaster. Really reviewing and updating those plans. The supply chain is dynamic. They've got to keep that evergreen as well, understanding the interdependencies in the systems, and also improving the supply chain knowledge, and as well as including regional and national implications of disruptions that could occur. Really, we're looking to states to look beyond their borders and make sure they understand all the interdependencies. So that's a quick summary. What I'd like to do for you now is just real quickly on each of the seven recommendations, go into just a bit of detail around, you know, some of the progress observed and maybe some more detail on opportunities for improvement. And again, these first four around operational framework and getting things in place, getting the structure there, the people, the processes, et cetera. So the first one here around harmonizing DOE's energy response team structure evolves around the NIMS ICS, of course. And so we certainly saw progress there that was evident clearly in the exercise. And we simply see that we can continue that journey, continue that effort in the way of improvement opportunities. And the way that they're designing their emergency preparedness and response is to keep embedding a little deeper into the ICS structure and really avoid terminology that creates confusion. It's very easy to get in your own world of management because that's what we're all used to. But when you're in an emergency and you're complying with a command system that has other agencies, other industry involved, it's important that you come together on that program and those structures. That includes clarifying roles and responsibilities, aligned with the ICS positions, and documenting those in the emergency response plans that DOE has. Understanding the ICS work processes and tools. It's not just the positions and the structure. There's tools with the ICS process that I think are very helpful in managing and planning and the cycle of dealing with an emergency as it occurs. Expanding the pool of trained staff. If you can understand a scenario like the one we described and used for ClearPath 4, this is going to go on for a significant duration. Do you have the staff and the bench strength really to cover that over time? It's a 24-hour a day for months duration is what we'd be expecting here. And then finally, enhancing the Emergency Operations Center logistics, making sure that that space that you're working from can accommodate participants from external and security clearances and such. The communications are reliable in that center, You have redundant systems, really enough space to really do the things that that you need to do to respond effectively. We really see this first recommendation is the foundation for many of the other, the cornerstone really for many of the other recommendations in the report. Recommendation two is around the Energy Information Administration, and we, as noted, we did observe very good participation by EIA in the exercise, particularly around situational awareness and really being able to leverage their industry contacts and procedures that they have in place. EIA's role within the ERO enhanced its communication interface with industry to provide a nice situational awareness for the exercise. In the way of opportunities to improve, I would just say that, you know, just continue to build that capability through training and exercises. Recommendation three speaks to company liaisons. We do have that company contact list in place, which is good, I've noted. MPC, Oil and Natural Gas Subcommittee, and EIA have compiled that list. EIA is the owner of that list, a primary holder. And a current list includes a very high percentage of the refining capacity companies as well as the midstream pipeline companies, as you see. Additionally, the oil and natural gas sector has updated their appendix on emergency management during supply chain disruptions to reflect these company liaisons. So as far as continuing this and improving, you know, as I've said earlier, we've simply got to make sure we have a process in place to keep this evergreen, to validate it, test it. We can imagine some tests going out in the future, your company's contacts getting contacted, them contacting you to say, I've been contacted, here's what we would do, and this is how we would start to engage. So that's what we'd like to see. You have to test these things and make sure they work and keep them alive. Uh-oh. There we go. Back on recommendation four, and this is the final one around, you know, the operational framework, and it has to do with regulatory relief. And of course, these are time sensitive. When you actually need some relief, it's probably too late. So you have to anticipate down the road when you're going to have some relief for a certain regulation during a response. And a lot of times we can see that coming. We can see down the road. And I think what this speaks to is just being ready for those and understanding the process to get those done effectively. So I'll tell you that regulatory relief was not a major component of the exercise in itself, although the DOE did process a request that we observed in the exercise. So we saw that as a positive. They took that on, and I was glad to see that. We did understand that there was a bit of difficulty in really following through on the process of completing that regulatory relief, and this one in the exercise was for a Jones Act waiver. And so I think what comes out of that is just the complexities of getting something like that done. It's not easy. It involves a lot of other agencies, DHS, Department of Transportation, etc. And these are things that I don't think the government should take lightly. It's a waiver from the regulation, so it has to be thought out in advance. I see an area here to improve preparedness in that regard. I think the API handbook on emergency preparedness has a list of all the potential waivers we could see in a disruptive event. And so I think maybe an area for improvement here is to kind of take on that list and really think about the priorities of the ones that we think we can develop some procedures up front and kind of have those in the response plan that we can take out and then effectively try to execute in a timely fashion during an event. Of course, fuel supply during an event is obviously critical, so this is something that we think is a key thing to focus on. Okay. Number five, and now we're into the third, kind of the last three, which is grouped around sustaining the process and keeping things alive and keeping them evergreen. The states, this one's around energy assurance again for the states and engaging with industry. We did see progress in the Clear Path 4 exercise. The states of Washington and Oregon had plans, and they were working with those plans during the exercise, and that was good to see. And that's how you test these things, in an exercise. There's good collaboration between DOE and the National Association of State Energy Officials, NASIO, on improving coordination with states. We see that. So there's progress that's made and should be applauded. The Energy Emergency Assurance Coordinator, a memorandum of understanding, in fact, has been signed by Secretary Moniz just in February this year. So this is all good progress and great to see. Regarding opportunities in this space, I would say it's just around expanding the education and outreach, really under steady state or peacetime conditions, making sure that we have good understanding, good liaisons, a good feel for interdependencies of the supply chain across state lines, that those preparedness plans for state, local, and federal are in place to allocate resources in that case, and then establishing routine review and updates of those state energy assurance plans. Recommendation 6 speaks to education and training. Certainly when you're instituting a new system of management like ICS, it involves a lot of understanding and training on how that all works together. We've seen a lot of good work done with regard to training in the past year or so. EIA has completed some of their reports, which in a way is training on the Petroleum Administration for Defense districts, and those serve as good tools for situational awareness in an event. The Oil and Natural Gas Subcommittee continues to outreach and share industry expertise and experience through the Energy Coordinating Council. And then API has updated their handbook on oil and natural gas industry preparedness. All these things good and speaks to continuing education. We do see obviously some continued work that certainly should be done in this space regarding particularly, you know, as I spoke to earlier, the high turnover. How do we embed a training program on certain key positions for ICS, keep that alive and keep the education going, continuing to reinforce DOE's role under ESF 12, as I've mentioned, and provide education on that role and interaction with the states as a result of that support function. And then continuing to educate on the supply chains, of course, which are complex. A lot of players involved, a lot of dynamics involved with the supply chain. And, you know, that includes, you know, certainly the networks that are involved, industry capabilities, antitrust considerations, et cetera, as well as training on all the ICS institutional response framework that's associated. The final recommendation is 7, and it's around drills and exercises. And I, you know, obviously the progress observed and noted is the ClearPath 4. Just a tremendous amount of effort went into planning and executing that event in Portland, as well as in DC. And that was a very good venue for us training, understanding, and collaborating together. And that's really, really what's at heart here. At the Energy Government Coordinating Council, industry shared information on upcoming exercises. So this is ongoing now and in place, and we'll continue to make that exercise slate, if you will, visible to all so that there's a good sharing of information on exercises and joint collaboration there. And I know that DOE has started observing some company exercises, and I know they've observed a Exxon and Marathon Petroleum exercise as of late. As far as opportunities to improve, just to continue the outreach and collaboration. When we have a disruptive event like a earthquake, a hurricane, we can't do it alone. We have to collaborate. We need government. And I think government needs industry. We need to understand each other's capabilities, what we can bring to the table. So it's just vital that we have, and the best way to prepare for that, of course, is through an exercise, an integrated exercise. So, you know, that would also include embracing the use of ICS coaches. You know, we utilize the Coast Guard a lot for our offshore assets. They have these strike teams. We have subject matter expertise consulting out there now and within our own companies that can be leveraged for this. Formalizing a process to share industry exercise schedules. I've talked about that. I think that's low-hanging fruit, actually. I think we get those exercises out there. It's open invitations. Let's get folks involved. And then finally, having government not only observe, but actually participate in our exercises. Take roles. That's what we want. And I think that's the best way for us to learn and improve together. With that, I'll conclude with the fact that, you know, this emergency preparedness is actually a journey. It's a long-term endeavor. And I think the Clear Path exercise went a tremendous way in providing an opportunity for government, both federal and state, working with industry to advance our emergency preparedness in this regard. Responses to supply chain emergencies are best managed through planning. You have to plan up front and being prepared, along with the private and public sector collaboration. We, you know, government and industry share a commitment in this space. I truly believe that, and that's to prepare for and respond to emergency supply disruptions. And this isn't easy. This is not easy, particularly in times of long durations of no incidents. We tend to get focused on other things. And so it takes a commitment. We know disasters will occur. And the ability of our collective government and industry being able to respond effectively to minimize the impacts are vitally important. So I want to applaud the work that DOE has done to build this readiness. And while the NPC project work is concluded, industry certainly looks forward to continuing to work jointly with DOE and other agencies to continue to improve and sustain the program in the future. So thank you very much, and I'll take some questions if you have any. And I've also noted here the website for NPC where these materials will be housed, as well as the detailed working paper that can provide you a lot more information in this regard.
So do we have any questions? Sir.
Do we have a mic? Down front here.
There's a mic coming up.
So excellent report, and thank you for the work that you've been doing. My question is this: the tabletop exercise that you did, what was the time frame over which the exercise occurred? My question is this: there is a lot, obviously, that goes into immediate event response, but then there's a whole series of aftermath events, right, in order to get the situation back to, you know, post-trauma normal.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering how deep you got into those aftermath events.
Yeah.
You know, I'm thinking things like, you know, you could easily imagine situations where there are certain dislocation of people and resources, environmental spills and the like, and how did the exercise anticipate them and address them?
Yep. It's a good question, and it's tremendously complex. And you can design these things to address any and all of that. The exercise started as an initial kind of response and how we're going to act in the early hours. And that occurred on the day one of a tabletop discussion that we had in Portland. So it was a 4-hour kind of tabletop, just focusing on the immediate kind of what's happened. Let's come together. What do we know? How are we going to understand? How are we going to begin to assemble ourselves and start thinking about how we move forward together? The afternoon was were the workshops on fuels and energy and electricity that we focused and referenced. The second day, and most of the day, I'd say 4 to 6 hours perhaps, was dedicated to what we call a functional exercise, and that's where there's players, there's controllers, simulating play, and we extended that realism. Was it 72 hours? 72 hours down the road. I mean, so this is the challenge with exercising, and we've done some in our country. Certainly, you've got to be ready to go initially and come together, and then you have to kind of script where could you be down the road, because that's really when a lot of the hard things start to happen, right? And so you can take various approaches, but that was the approach taken for Clear Path 4. Over here, first row, please. Thanks.
Jason Bordoff with Columbia University Center on Global Energy Policy. Quick FYI and then a related question. So many of us were closely involved in the response to Superstorm Sandy. And then Mayor Bloomberg's administration had asked us at Columbia University to convene a series of high-level workshops. Several of you in the room participated in that, state and local officials as well. Develop a series of recommendations for how to improve situational awareness in the tri-state area for fuel system resilience. A very lengthy report came out yesterday that summarized all the results of that that three-year process, and that's available on our website for anyone who wants to look at it. The question relates to one of the things we talked a lot about in there. It's a question for you, Phil, maybe for the Deputy Secretary too, which is, so you mentioned management of change process, mm-hmm. and I think that's incredibly important given not only change in industry, but in 6 months, yeah. the senior level leadership in the federal government will change. The memory that those of us have who worked on this, the importance of personal relationships for how to improve information and just know who to get on the phone with in those kind of fog of war situations that dissipates over time. And I was wondering if you could say more about what that looks like and how to actually implement that, what it looks like on the private sector and what it looks like in the public sector to make sure that the importance of this issue and the knowledge that we've spent all this time building over the last 3 or 4 years gets passed along.
Yeah. Thank you. Good question. I guess at the core of it for me is, you know, when you think about a large event like that, imagine this category, you know, 8.0 earthquake and a tsunami that basically liquefied the west coast of the northwest there. You simply can't go into that ad hoc, and you can't go into it in your own industry and government regimes and expect it to work together. So, you know, you have to envelop a program that is going to have the key roles within the ICS system that is embedded, and that folks retain that institutional knowledge over time. So what it means really a lot of times is folks are double-hatted. You know, they'll have their own role in industry and in government, but they'll also be the planning section chief or the operations section chief or the public information officer. And that way, when the public information officer comes from the government and from the industry, they're speaking the same language, they're working together. And so you have to somehow build that sustained process of really positions and roles within the organization. Very hard to do, especially in peacetime when there's been no incidents. So why do you want me to do this? I've got my other job to do. So it may not be a dedicated role. We have some dedicated roles in Shell, speaking for our company, but a lot of our roles particularly are those double-hatted roles where we have to continually get folks to come to exercises, continually give them some training refreshers so that they can come in and fill those roles when needed. It takes a lot of commitment. It's not easy, but that's how I see it.
Thanks, Jason.
Could you turn on the table mic, please?
Should I just speak loud?
I think it's on right now.
Is it working? Yes, it's now working. Good morning, everybody. Jason, thank you. I would just like to first note that you have put your finger on a very important question, which is the sustainability over time of these efforts and the follow-on effects of a disaster and how we deal with them. And in the exercising that we are doing inside the government, for example, we certainly see that our capabilities are stressed. And when we don't have sufficient human resources to sustain the level of effort required in those first 72 hours, it's an enormous challenge. And we have a mission in the Department of Energy that is currently not matched by resources in terms of emergency response. So I think this will be work for the next team to address, because you're right that after the first days, if we get into weeks and months, we saw this in the GRIDX 3 exercise, for example, that we did, we're in a very different world. To Jason's question, I'd make a couple of comments. First of all, each of us, we, the federal leadership that we'll hand over to our successors in January, and the industry leadership that will meet with our successors, have a responsibility to educate them as to the priority of this work we have done together and how far we've come and, again, what more work we need to do. Because this responsibility will never go away, and indeed the threat environment is such that we are only going to, I think, face increasing need to prepare and coordinate closely, and to your point, know who to call in a crisis. We will have a very deliberate transition effort across the Obama administration. It's actually already begun, and after Election Day, we will have counterparts with whom we'll work from the elected president's team, and this will certainly be a part of what I brief is the work we have done thus far and what lies ahead. We also importantly have career civilian leadership, similar to the way the career military carries work forward on the national security front at the Pentagon. Our career civilians who lead this effort, such as Devin Strait, who's sitting in the audience here, and others who will be responsible for carrying this work forward and who know what has been done, who know how things work, who know who to work with in industry. So I am also confident that we will not have a huge gap. And in fact, we can't as a nation afford to have a gap because we never know what will happen. Indeed, we know that up until the day of the inauguration, we have the responsibility for this work. And as we hand the baton over, we have to be ready on day one for what might happen.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Phil. Your team has really done an extremely valuable service in providing this addendum. I reflect back when the council originally considered taking on the emergency preparedness study, and one of the things that we all recognized, and it was referenced in one of the questions that came out of Superstorm Sandy, is that while as individual companies we have our own emergency preparations, we're prepared to respond to situations that involve our operations, our assets, our people, but in many instances, it's natural disasters, broader disasters that affect multiple companies, communities, governments, people, and that takes a special type of plan to be pulled together that involves all these things that are being tested, the collaboration, the ability to get, in some instances, waivers from existing policies and rules, and that was really the core and the essence of preparing this original report. We all know that in the event of a disaster that involves energy and energy supplies, that the public will hold us, industry, as well as the government, accountable for addressing that and responding it. And so it was critical that we work together to prepare a plan that was truly an integrated collaborative plan that would allow us to be better prepared to respond to emergencies in the future. We don't know when that will happen, but in the case of natural disasters, we know that sooner or later something will happen and that we need to be prepared for it. So again, I certainly want to thank not only the original team that developed this report, but also Phil and your team for what you have done to carry through with these additional recommendations. And I think it's certainly embedded in those recommendations is that this continue to be an ongoing process. That while NPC has now gone through a couple of work processes to develop the original report and to enhance it, is that industry and government needs to continue to work together to test this and enhance it going forward, because we don't know whether it's going to be next month or a year from now or 2 years from now, but we know that something will occur that we need to be prepared, and it'll be critical that we are not scrambling around at the last minute to dust things off. So I think a lot of these questions about continuity are critical, because we have continuity. We have changes in our own companies, in our industry structure. We have changes in regulations that affect how we work together, and we have changes in government. So again, thank you for your efforts on this. I believe that the council should submit the results of this follow-up activity to the secretary as an appropriate response to his March 23 letter. And as also part of our council's commitment that we reflected and iterated back when we approved the emergency responses original report and recommendations. I want to point out that this addendum is about the 2014 report's recommendations, and it does not propose new recommendations just on how to enhance it. So for this reason, council approval is not required of the text, but we are asking for council approval to go ahead and transmit this to the secretary, as well as posting it on the National Petroleum Council's website. So I think we've had an opportunity for questions on the report. So I would like at this time to entertain a motion to approve sending this transmittal letter along with the complete slide deck that Phil just went through, to transmit that to Secretary Moniz and posting these addendum materials on the NPC website. So could I have a motion on that, please? I have a motion here. Is there a second? I have a second. Thank you. Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Well, again, thank you very much. The addendum is approved for transmission to the secretary and posting on the website.